Evening is the 19th of the Jewish month of Kislev. It's a very special date, not only for Lubavitch Hasidim, not only for world Jewry, but in fact for all of mankind. We know that the responsibility of every individual is global. God Almighty empowers every human being with affecting, in a positive way, his entire surrounding, and ultimately, the entire world. So 200 years ago, on this day, the then leader of world Jewry, Rabbi Shneur Zalman of Liadi, the first Lubavitcher Rebbe, was released from prison on false accusations. And we are taught that actually what took place was really a spiritual challenge. It was a heavenly court, and it just manifested itself and expressed itself down here in Russia at the time. And it represents the victory of right, of godliness, as opposed to a non-godly world. Tonight we're here to learn about, to discuss, to understand the seven Noahide commandments, the universal commandments. We're fortunate to have with us tonight a number of individuals that are actually experts in the field. We have some very impressive video presentations, and certainly everybody is going to be able to gain much from this evening. But before we even begin, I just want to stress that we're not just here tonight to learn a bit, hopefully to enjoy ourselves. It's not just for entertainment. We're to walk out from this evening charged with the mission of changing the world for good, and realizing that every human being on the planet, every person has this responsibility to make the world the perfect godly world that it was created for. We're now going to watch a video presentation which was put together a number of years ago, and it's very informative, and it's in English. So for those of you which speak other languages, whether you understand only Spanish, French, Arabic, I don't think we have any subtitles to it, so I just hope that you'll be able to do well with this so-called international language. It is the language of the country, and even where I come from, the United States, we speak something which we call English. I know that some of the English people take offense of that, but sorry. But this video presentation is an English one.
In 1989, U.S. President George Bush signed a proclamation recognizing the seven laws of Noah as the principles of moral and ethical conduct that have formed the basis of all civilizations. In 1991, a joint resolution of Congress, U.S. Public Law 10214, stated that the seven Noahide laws have been the bedrock of society from the dawn of civilization. The following presentation outlines the seven Noahide laws and describes their connection to world unity.
There comes a time as we watch our lives unfold, when the world feels strange, future unknown.
Hello, I'm Jeff Weiser, reporting for CBC World News. Last week's unprecedented unilateral world peace agreement, which officially ended all armed conflicts around the globe, has now gone into effect. World peace, once only the dream of religious groups, is now reality. As today, the United Nations reported there were no deaths due to armed conflict anywhere in the world.
Hashem chose us as His glorious design. He'll make this world a better place for you and me.
Today, in medical news, we are proud to report the last mystery of cancer has been uncovered by a British scientist, and the disease has been eliminated from mankind.
In economic news today, the economy soars despite the 12-hour work week, which went into effect last week. The once-dreaded dot-com industry's upturn during the past 6 months has been the needed catalyst to bring the world economy to levels never before seen in the history of mankind.
We are your world. We are your children. We are the ones to show you how to love the life you're living.
This ideal state of being of world peace, everyone can contribute to this one big family. It is our dream to work for it. I think it is possible. I think we need to believe in the possibility of it.
When the world reaches its point of perfection, it'll be that kind of life. There'll be no war, there'll be no hatred, there'll be no hunger, there'll be no poverty, there'll be no tears, there'll be no pain, there'll be no suffering. And everything that's going on now is just bringing the world to that ultimate stage.
How do we get there? We have to refine the world. We have to transform the world. We have to make the world a better place. How do you make the world a better place?
You need to have a system. The oldest and most universal divine system in place is called the Noahide laws. Noahide because they originate from Noah, who was a survivor after a flood that came as a result of a corrupt world. So in a sense, Noah becomes the man, the father of civilization, and sets into motion laws by which civilization should never destroy itself again.
The rainbow is the covenant in which God states that he will not destroy mankind, and it's a covenant between him and the world. And this shows that God is directly involved with his creatures and that he wishes them to exist.
When he gave these laws to Noah, he said, this is for you and for your sons and for the generations to come. So basically what we're living in now is basically disobeying what God wanted. So ultimately, if we do keep those seven commandments we were given, we would actually do what God actually wanted us to do in the beginning.
Number one is that there's a God. There's an eye that sees, there's an ear that hears. There's a higher presence in our lives. We're not alone.
This world has a purpose there. And that purpose is to make this world a dwelling place for God. And each one of us was endowed with a responsibility to bring that about. And every single one of us has a role in that grand divine plan.
The belief in God is the belief that the world has a manager. It has management principles that are beyond my wishes or my desires. To some extent, there can be nothing more hopeful than that. I believe that the world is a world of chaos, a world of violence. It's a very depressive world.
I was born in China, a culture that doesn't encourage religion, so I wasn't grow up with the concept of God. However, I do believe in some kind of spiritual being that is overseeing our individual life, giving us direction, if only we can listen to it.
Number two is respect for the divine. You shouldn't blasphemize God's name. What it really means is many people can believe in God, but the God is somewhere up in heaven. It doesn't affect how you speak. It doesn't affect how you behave. So essentially, this is about applying it to the way you communicate at the table, in your home, even when you're nervous, even when you're aggravated. The God's presence is with you, and you always maintain that type of respect.
It includes also the obligation to pray to God, to communicate with God, to ask of God things. And God listens, as our Torah teaches us, and to develop a relationship with God, a personal relationship with God.
A person cannot have be overpowered by an immature idea of God where he evinces anger and frustration against. against the creator of the universe.
Number three is respect for life. Thou shalt not murder. You must respect life, absolutely.
The criteria for murder is not to kill someone who doesn't want to be killed. The criteria for murder is not want to take a life. Why? Because life isn't yours. It was given to you. So you have to guard and watch and preserve. But you don't own your own life, let alone somebody else's life. And taking another life of a person whose life wants to be taken, like this whole craze of euthanasia, is biblically prohibited. It's against the Torah to murder another human being, whether or not that human being, even if the human being is willing. You don't own your own life. You're not allowed to take your own life. It's against the Torah. And I want to add one piece of controversy, but a very real controversy. According to Jewish law, within the framework of the seven laws of Noah, abortion is murder. Killing an unborn baby who would live if you would be allowed to live is murder. Unfortunately, in our society, you don't get punished for it. You don't become a mitzvah, a commandment, like something that shows you to be what do they call it, a progressive human being. But as an individual, there should be a sense of awareness, of conscience, of consciousness. This is taking a life. Life doesn't belong to you. You have no right to destroy it.
Number four is respect for family, which means sexual conduct that is not incestuous, that is not abusive.
You can't have a society with simply rampant, unbridled sexual instinct. And so there must be control of the sexual instinct. And sexuality in man has to have an objective. And the objective is procreation. So the Torah cannot sanction an institution where the sexuality is simply self-indulgent and there is no benefits for mankind.
Number five is respect for property. Thou shalt not steal. So not just respect for someone's life, it's also respect for other people's property.
If I believe that there is a force that unites both of us, then just as I want something, I have to consider that you want something. Just as I own something, then you own something. And just as I want what is good for me, I must want what is good for you. This is the principle of Hillel. What is hateful unto you, don't do unto your brother.
Even if that person will never know you stole from them, and even if that person wouldn't care that you stole from them, you're not allowed to steal. It's wrong. It's against God's principle.
Number six is to set up a system of law and order, a justice system, courts, so there's accountability, and people have a certain responsibility to themselves and to society.
That entails both people who teach law, shoftim, judges, and people who enforce law, where right and justice is upheld, and where evil and wrong is punished. But included within that, there is a whole broad kaleidoscope of particulars that have to do with upstanding morality, like charity, like visiting the sick, like burying the dead, like worrying about the less fortunate and the destitute. And a very significant one, compromise. Don't drive everything to its miserable end. That people should be able to forgive another person.
Now finally, number seven is respect for creatures. And specifically in Hebrew is called Evam Min Achai, that you shall not eat from the limb of an animal that's alive because it tortures it. So it's respect for life.
In today's world, cultism and belief in magical powers and animals are, by the way, slaughtered and attempts are made to gain their power, so it is very common in our society. You may not see it out in the street every day, but you read about it and it's there. And this type of a thing is something which has had a major influence on many, many societies.
This is a very humanistic law that you as a human being have to have compassion, not only to your parents and not only to your society, but also to animals. That you have to have compassion for everyone, for all of God's creations.
The whole purpose of these laws is to make someone is to reveal the spirituality within each person, and that anyone can relate to, because that's the whole concept of a human being. A human being has that soul within him.
You have a soul. It's a beautiful soul. Why don't you live up to it? And here's how you can live up to it. Here are the guidelines. There are guidelines. There's a blueprint for life. It's called the Universal Blueprint. But we're discussing the Noahide laws. It's a guidebook, how to live the best you can live.
And the dream is, my house, says the prophet, will be a house of prayer for all nations. God will be one and his name will be one. It means that all the peoples of the world are going to be united into the great humanity, and united humanity, which God intended from the beginning.
There comes a time, as we watch our lives unfold, when the world feels strange, future unknown.
Hello, I'm Joanne Chung, reporting live from Beijing. We are very honored to announce the new World Peace Alliance signed last week in New York City has been unanimously accepted by officials in China.
We are your world. We are your children. We are the ones to show you how to love the life you're living. Hashem chose us as his glorious design.
United Nations. And the United Nations is an organization which is in which country? Well, it's in New York, but I think legally or technically, it's really supposed to be in no country, and that's why it's not in Washington, in the capital. So it's really in New York, but it's for all the nations. And you have all of the nations of the world there. Now, unfortunately, at times, and too often, there may be corruption there. But ideally, what the United Nations is all about, and the fulfillment of the seven Noahide laws was always necessary, as mentioned before, 3,500 years ago. However, now, in our generation, in the current times, it's most emphasized because the prophet of our generation, the leader of world Jewry, and in fact, the leader of the world, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, King Moshiach, has emphasized time and time again the importance of spreading the seven mitzvahs, the seven commandments, the Noahide laws. Now in a talk, the Rebbe King Moshiach explains that the UN was established with a purpose, as we all know, for world peace. Well, that's what it's all about. And specifically the time and the location, all is connected with the Messiah himself and with his coming, which is where right now we're at the threshold of the times of the Messianic era. That's why it was established then, which is around the same time that the Rebbe Messiah came to the United States. So it's really supposed to be a place where the nations of the world get together and serve God. Well, we have with us here tonight an individual who works on that end of it. He's the director of the UN NGO Institute of Noahide Code. This is Rabbi Yaakov David Cohen, who came all the way from New York to be with us tonight. And he works on a regular, consistent basis in the United Nations. I don't think he has an official seat there. He's not representing any nation, but he's greater than that in a sense. He's actually representing God, Moses, the Torah, and bringing it to the nations of the world. So without any further ado, Rabbi Cohen, please.
Yom Tiv, greetings and blessings, welcome. Tonight we're going to talk about one people, one world, one good deed. And we're going to focus on one word, and more particularly one letter. The word is Echad. Echad and the word Aleph. The question is asked, in the Gemara it says that why did God create the world with a base? Bereishis bara Elokim es ha-shamayim ve'es ha-aretz. And the letter Beis came with a question, why not with an Aleph? So Hashem said, don't worry, the letter Aleph is reserved for the Torah. The Torah is a Noichi, it begins with an Aleph. The Aleph is represented, the first letter. And what is the Aleph, even though the Beis is Bracha, is Beis for Bracha, but the letter Aleph represents the oneness of God. And the oneness of God is represented when we say the Shema. When we say the Shema, we say Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad. Again, the word Echad, one, not Yachid, which means unity, singular, or only. The word one means that there could be a second. And the question is asked, why did God create, why do we say the prayer of Hashem Echad and not Hashem Yachid? Which means Hashem is only. To understand this, we're going to take a step back forward for 1 second. The word one implies that there could be a second. Meaning that we take from before God created the world, There was absolute unity. Achdus Hashem. God had unity. The reason why he created the world is to have duality come together as one. That's why when we say Echad, we want people, individuals, not that we don't want everyone to look the same or be the same. As it says in the Gemara, in Sanhedrin, that God minted all people from Odom Arishim, from one person, yet two people do not look alike, do not think alike, do not talk alike, and they differ from various different aspects. And the reason being is that Hashem, God, wants that each individual should all come together. God wants we should worship the one God. In other words, for God to have unity, he needs multiple people coming together and joining as one. For people, for